Okay, now Nicole's going to come and read 1 John 1, 1-5. Before she does that, can I just say, we read the Bible, and people think, well, of course you read the Bible because it's a church, but it's partly dead boring, and partly why should we read the Bible? Well, it's not. It's God's way of speaking to us, and you'd be amazed at how he speaks to us. I don't know how many times you've read your favorite book. You know, I've read Lord of the Rings a few times. I hate to confess it, I've read Pride and Prejudice about 20 times. It's my go-to chick flick book when I'm feeling I need a little feminine reassurance, you know. But I think I've probably read the whole Bible well over 100 times. I read it every year, and it's in full, and I just keep finding new stuff in it. It's the most amazing book in the world, and that's why we read it. So we've been looking at John's gospel. John was one of Jesus' disciples very early on, very, very interesting character, and he wrote three letters later on, and 1 John is just an amazing letter. I think it's one of the most beautiful pieces of writing ever. It's largely about love, and you really do need to read it, but Nicole's just going to read 1 John 1, verses 1 to 5.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. Amen.
If you're going to take one thought away today or this evening, God is light. In him there's no darkness at all. It's just a beautiful and extraordinary thing. Now, we're going to sing one of the songs from the Bible, Psalm 85. It may be that we're singing this because it speaks of truth and righteousness, and you may say, well, what do these words mean? But we're going to look at these so as we in a moment, but I thought we would sing this first. So let's sing Psalm 85.
We'll stand.
Yeah.
before him.
Great, have a seat. You're in good voice tonight. Now, I did a very dangerous thing. I asked for people to comment on what we were doing, and we're going to ask that again next week as well. And it was great to get some comment, and one of the comments was that there's quite a lot in what we look at, and sometimes people don't get it all. And that's fair enough. I think that's a really good comment. So I was asked if I'd produce some notes. So I have. So where's Sherry? Sherry's going to come up. If you'd like some notes, just put your hand up and Sherry will give you one. Well, I didn't give everyone because it's not everyone's cup of tea, but if you'd like one, just put your hand up and you can have a note. And it's typed out, so it's not my writing, so you won't find it confusing. Now, while Sherry's doing that, I'm going to ask Terry, can you play just a little bit of music? We were going to play a video, but we lost the video, so... just bear with Terry. I think we've got the music. Let's see if you recognize this.
Thinking of investing? See what your house is worth and...
Oh. You don't recognize that. No, I think we're... Okay. Won't. I'll tell you that it's a strange bit of music to play in church, and I wouldn't normally play it, but you'll see why we're going to do it in a moment.
You must know this one.
John Lennon, but I think that's an absolutely dreadful song in lots of ways. But what astounds me, the reason I played that is, that was played at the 2011 Olympics. It's been played at two other Olympics and two Winter Olympics, and people are saying it's the anthem for humanity. Well, if it is, humanity's in a lot of trouble, because it's one of the most hypocritical songs you will ever hear. Why? As I said, I absolutely love John Lennon. When he was killed, I know this sounds weird, I was at university, but I spent a whole day in bed just mourning him. But he said, imagine no possessions. A guy who has five houses and 20 cars. You know, imagine no countries. We sing at an Olympics where it's all about celebrating different countries. You know, and the idea, you may say I'm a dreamer, you hope you'll, one day you'll join us and the world will be as one. Well, it's a lovely ideal, but it's not going to happen. And we need something to come and to change that. Now, we've been looking at John's gospel. And if you go to John chapter 1, we've been looking at how God sent Jesus. When you say, what has God done? He sent Jesus. And then we've looked at how Jesus is the light that gives light to everyone coming into the world. And we're going to look at this extraordinary passage that I think what I want to say is, I want to say it's very applicable to those of you who are not Christians, because I want you to see something of what you're missing. But I also want to challenge those of us who are Christians, because I think sometimes we're missing this as well. So, verse 14 of John chapter 1 says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. By the way, there's an opportunity to ask questions at the end, so if you've got them, please do let me know. Now, glory. Let's just talk about glory first. We're going to talk about glory, grace, and truth. So let's talk about glory. So I thought I would illustrate glory with a present that Sam gave me. Okay? I was going to use this one, by the way, but they don't have much glory, so I can't really go with them. But Sam, what's this? It's an Everton shirt. When did Everton last win something? I don't know, but when Everton have won the FA Cup and they have won a league, and people wear the shirt. Now, why do people wear the shirt? Even if they don't play football. I mean, you see men who are kind of like the size of double-decker buses who wear this as though they're athletic. They wear it because they want to share the glory. You know, I watched Germany, a YouTube clip recently of Germany and Brazil, where Germany won 7-1. And it was showing the reactions of a crowd in a massive pub, and they were all in Brazilian shirts. By halfway, when they were 5-0 down, there were no Brazilian shirts left. They're just gone, and suddenly German shirts appeared. But we glory is we understand a certain amount of glory in terms of sport, that it's you praise, you sing praise to people. Now, that's a very trivial example of what this world calls glory. There are different kinds of things in this world that people would call glory. But John talks about the glory of the one and only Son. And in 1 John, the passage that Nicole read, John says, we've seen it, we've touched it, we've heard it, we're telling you about the glory. Now you may say, well, I don't see Jesus. Okay, and you know what you see in the windows, that's, you know, you're right, you're not seeing Jesus, you don't see Jesus, but you can see him in his glory if you listen to those who did. Glory, by the way, for those of you who are into Greek and who isn't, or Latin, is doxa, from which we get the term doxology. People might say the doxology. Now, how do we see God's glory? The heavens declare the glory of God. So just go out at night, especially if you live in an area where there isn't much light pollution, and look up at the heavens. They declare the glory of God. The creation declares the glory of God. I saw a lovely painting today. Somebody showed me of what they painted, a black kookaburra on one of the lakes here. Absolutely stunning. Absolutely stunning. They declare the glory of God. You know, like when you, I'm trying to think of how to illustrate this. Let's say you're going out to a posh do, and your husband says to you, let's say your woman, put on your glad rags, you know, right? Don't go out scruffy. Or in my case, don't wear an Everton football shirt to a really posh do. Sorry, Sam, it's really good to wear, but not at a really posh do, okay? It's a black tie event. If you know what a black tie is. God has shown us his glory in what he has made. And that's astonishing. But he has also shown us his glory in Jesus Christ. So, how do we know God? In one sense, you can think about it rationally, and that helps. Or in another sense, there's mystical experiences, and they may help. But it's not enough. So what we're being told here is that in order to know God, we need to know Jesus. And see what it says here. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The Word is Jesus. Became flesh and made his dwelling among us. It's the idea is literally, he came and pitched his tent with us. He came to live among us. Right, we're here in Hamilton. Can you imagine what the Newcastle Herald would have if we've discovered that Taylor Swift had decided that Newcastle is so brilliant that she's bought a house here in Hamilton. And by the way, Paul McCartney is living next door as well, because he loved coming to Newcastle also. I mean, people would say, well, it's wonderful. Look, Newcastle's attracting all these people. But this is saying, God came to live amongst us. And that is quite astonishing. In Exodus 25, verse 8, so the Old Testament prepares us for all of this. And Exodus 25, verse 8 says, that they have made a sanctuary for me. Have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. So God in the Old Testament says, build me a temple, and I'll be in it. But now he says, I've come in the person of Jesus Christ, and I'm going to dwell in your house. So that's an extraordinary thing. When you become a Christian, it's not just that Jesus comes into your life, but he comes into your home. Remember that famous interview that Martin Bashir did with Lady Diana, and she said there were three of us in this marriage. It was really horrible, actually, really, really sad. But the Christian says that there are three of us in this marriage because Christ is with us. And that's actually not horrible. That's a remarkable blessing. In the Old Testament, and this is the language that John is using, the glory filled the temple. It was called the Shekinah glory. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could not enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. So what that's like is, it's like being in this building and there being such a presence that people couldn't come in. They couldn't cope. And yet, that's just a shadow of Jesus coming. And that's why I say that those of us who are Christians need to grasp this more and more, because I don't think we grasp enough of the glory of Christ, the glory of the one and only Son. Again, and there's a lot from Exodus, but you can see why. Exodus 33, verse 19, the Lord said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live. And then in 34, he goes on to say, then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. See, the Old Testament, they were told, you can't see God and live, but I will send my glory. And in the New Testament, Jesus comes down as God. He becomes flesh, and we do see him in one sense. And the more we get to know Christ, the more we see the glory of God. And that glory is seen in this. He came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So the glory has two things, grace and truth. And we're going to look at one of those just now. Let's go on to verses 15 to 16. This grace. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, this is the one I spoke about when I said, he who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. Out of his fullness, we have all received grace in place of grace already given. Just let me explain that first verse very simply. John the Baptist was the witness to Jesus. We've read that earlier. He came to talk about Jesus. It wasn't about himself. And he said, Jesus is greater than me because he existed before me. John understood that. He understood who Jesus was. At one point, he said, I must decrease, he must increase. Now, grace. What is grace? It's a really interesting thing. We sing the song Amazing Grace. We talk about grace in different ways, but do we understand it? Grace, if it helps you, comes from the root idea of beauty and charm. So you might say someone is very gracious. If I'm a grumpy old man, I'm not gracious, right? You know, if you say, how are you? And I go, yeah, all right. And you, I don't know, there's a cup of tea afterwards, we've got food and stuff afterwards, and I take it, yeah, thanks, this is rubbish. Well, obviously that's not gracious, right? So grace conveys something of beauty and something of charm. It is the word charis, and for those of you who know your church denominations, if you say you're charismatic, I would love it if it meant you're full of grace. It tends to mean today that you believe in certain spiritual gifts, but grace here is God coming to us. And look, he says, we've all received grace in place of grace already given. Now, that's a strange expression. I sat down and thought about it and thought, how do I explain that? And then I thought, I don't even know what it means. So I had to, you know, go and look and think about it more and more. And what he's saying is this. Christ overflows with grace. So it's like a fountain. And out of his fullness we receive, and Christ keeps on giving. It's not like you get a certain amount, and then that's it. You know, so you become a Christian, and you get some grace, and then you just got to hold on to what you've got, if you possibly can, until you die or until Jesus comes back. What we're being told here is an extraordinary thing. He says he gives more grace. He gives more grace. He gives more grace. You might think, for example, let me give you an example of this in a practical way. You might think, do you know this? I could never, ever cope with what that person has gone through. And you dread the thought of it. There are things I dread the thought of. But God says, no, my grace is sufficient for you. You know, you can cope. You will be able to cope because I will give you that grace. So grace upon grace is really actually grace instead of grace. And it's saying God gives you grace and then he gives you more grace and then he gives you more grace. And it's like a continuing flow of beauty into your lives. So much in our lives can be incredibly ugly. So the man who wrote Amazing Grace was a man called John Newton. Now, many of us know that he was a slave trader, and we think that when he wrote Amazing Grace, he was talking about how, as a slave trader, he'd been freed. To be honest, John Newton took some time as a Christian to realize that slavery was wrong. And you may condemn that, maybe rightly, but in the context of the culture at that time, Newton was still in a position where he'd hold a Bible study on a ship that was trading slaves. Now, he came to see that it was completely wrong, but it took time. But when he wrote Amazing Grace, what he was talking about was his lifestyle before he became a Christian, where although he was married, he was a philanderer, if you want to put it that way. He led a pretty dissolute life, and John Newton was saying, how could you save somebody like me? Because Christ is full of grace. I read this, I don't know where, so I can't from, but it says this. The spring is inexhaustible. It is full of grace and truth from God. It never loses anything, no matter how much we draw, but remains an infinite fountain of all grace and truth. The more you draw from it, the more abundantly it gives of the water that springs into eternal life. It's like you go to this fountain and you drink, and when you drink, there's more. And when you drink, there's more. And when you drink, there's more. The person who kind of goes, well, I want to be careful with the grace that I've got. That's not how it is. And again, there are so many images of this. For example, when you open a curtain and the sun comes in, imagine if you said, oh, I can't open the curtain because I'll let the light in and that will detract from the sun. That doesn't make any sense. It's the same with God's grace. Or solar panels on your roof. You're going to put I can't put solar panels on my roof because that will take away the power from the sun. I mean, that's how ridiculous it is. But us thinking that we've only got this much grace, and if we run out, it's done. That's what John is talking about. How do we get this grace? Truth. Let's go to verse 17. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Now, the law was basically the Ten Commandments and everything else that came around it. John is not saying that they were untrue or that they were ungracious. He's not saying that. But he's saying Moses ultimately can't give you grace and truth. And keeping the law won't give you grace and truth. If you think religion is about, and religion is about, lots of religions. When Lennon sang Imagine No Religion, I kind of understood that bit more. That was the least hypocritical bit of what he sang. Because lots of religion is about, you got to do this, and you got to do this, and you got to do this, and then you'll live. And then you'll please God. Or then you can join our group. But that's not what grace does. Grace says you're not worthy. Grace says, actually, there's nothing that you can do to save yourself, but I will save you. That's what grace says. And it's kind of, it's a bit like, I'm trying to think, how would I put this? Imagine you've got, on the one hand, I don't know, some Bitcoin that's one of these companies in Australia that's just gone bust, right? Or I say to you, I've discovered this money that I just printed off my computer, and I've got thousands of dollars of it. Here it is for you. You know, you can have that. Or on the other hand, I go, here's a pot of gold sovereign coins, each of them worth $1,000, and there's probably 1,000 in there. Which are you going to take? Now, that's what John is doing. He's contrasting. He's saying, this law and everything else, it's not enough to save us. And here comes Jesus, full of grace and truth. Now, we have seen his glory, he says. But what is that? When John says we've seen his glory, this is where pictures of Jesus get it wrong. Jesus was not walking around with a shiny face. Jesus was not walking around with a halo. If you met Jesus on the street in the first century, he'd be no different from anybody else. So what did he mean when we said we've seen his glory? The glory appears in human form, and some people do not recognize it because it's precisely not that. But Jesus was full of grace and truth. And that's how you see Jesus today, because as you read about Jesus, you discover his grace and his truth. He is so beautiful. And I have told this before, but it still remains to me one of the best examples of someone getting that. A Chinese student who came to a course that we were doing in the church hall, and she was crying, and my wife went to speak to her and asked her what was wrong, and she said, there's nothing wrong, it's just Jesus, he's so beautiful. She was crying because she saw the beauty of Christ. And this was a woman who'd never seen a Bible or been in a church. It's quite interesting, isn't it? A communist who just got it. And we so often let religion get in the way. You see, the devil is a liar and seeks to keep us away from the overflowing grace. The devil doesn't want us to know truth. And that's why verse 18, the last thing we look at, no one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. You can't see God, but God reveals himself to us through Jesus. Jesus says, anyone who's seen me has seen the Father. And you see the expression there, it says, he's in closest relationship with the Father. You know what that literally is? He's in the bosom of the Father. So it's a picture of a father with a child, and it's a really close relationship. And he's made him known. The word that's used there is a word those of you who are theologically trained will recognize. It's exegesis. Exegesis is what we mean by saying we take the Bible and we exegete, we take out what's there and explain it. Don Carson says that we might almost say that Jesus is the exegesis of the Father. If you want to know what the Father's right, look at Jesus. I think that's a very profound thing. Right, the glory, grace, and truth. Let me just wind it up in this way. Romans 3, verse 23. So the glory, we have a catechism question which says, what's humanity's chief purpose? Our chief purpose is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Now, Romans 3:23, this is fascinating for me because it says all have sinned, right? We've all sinned. Now, look, you might be sitting here saying, well, I'm not a Christian. Maybe I've done some things that are wrong and so on. And maybe you even become conscious of sin, which I really hope you do. But here's the thing. There isn't a single person here who could turn around and say, I haven't sinned or I've stopped sinning. It's just not true. All of us sin. I sin. All of us have sinned. Now, here's the astonishing thing. Again, I didn't notice this because I know the verse so well. I never thought about it really like this. Sinclair Ferguson, a great guy, I heard him say this week, and I just thought, yes, that, I've got to tell the people this. He said, all of us have sinned and we deserve to be punished, he said, is how I would put it. Or all of us have sinned and we're wicked people, is how I would have put it. But what does Paul say? All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Now, this is so important to guess. The worst thing about your sin is not that it's wicked and evil. The worst thing about it is that it's taken you away from God. And it means you fall short of the glory of God. And it means you're not what you should be or could be. It means you're not fulfilling your potential. And if you walk around going to say, well, I am who I am, well, I'm sorry, I wouldn't want to be you. You know, there's so much more that you can have and can be. And so that glory, the point about the glory and the grace and the truth, the glory is Jesus coming to us, but the glory is also something that we are to share in. And the grace, I read this week as well. Forgive the language, it's Puritan language, but I love this. A little sugar will suffer well enough for sweet wines. Now, I've never put sugar in wine, but I must try it. Apparently they did in those days. So a little sugar will suffer well enough for sweet wines, but much more is requisite to sweeten that wine which is sharp and hard. A little grace will make a very glorious show in such men and women whose natural tempers are sweet, soft, gentle, meek, affable, courteous. When a great deal of grace is sometimes hardly discernible in those men and women whose very natural tempers are crass, crooked, choleric, fierce, passionate, rough, and unhewn. In other words, you and I need grace. We need grace to be more like Christ. We need grace to be gracious people. Maybe you've got a nature which is naturally sweet and affable. Maybe under the surface you're not, but anyway, maybe that's how it comes across. But maybe you've been battered and bruised and hurt and wounded, and you're touchy, and you get angry very quickly, and people irritate you so much. How can you show the grace of God to people like that? You know, you want to thump them rather than hug them. How can you be gracious? Do you have to fake it? Do you have to say, well, oh, that's lovely, and I really like you, and thank you so much, while inwardly you're going, oh, if only I could say what I really think. You need to be changed, and you're changed by the graciousness of Christ. And I think for those of us who are Christians, whether you need a little sugar or a lot of sugar, we all need more grace, don't we? And it's there, and we should take it. 2 Peter 3:15 says this. 3:15 says this. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that you have. So tell people the truth. But do this with gentleness and respect. Show people grace. Be kind to people. Kindness is so important. We live in a very unkind world. Be kind to people, even on social media. And at this point, I'm looking in a mirror and going, you hypocrite. So, you know, I understand. It's difficult. But Christ is full of grace and truth. And we can live lives like that. An old hymn says this, you are the everlasting word, the Father's only Son, God manifestly seen and heard in heaven's beloved one. Worthy, O Lamb of God, art thou, that every knee to thee should bow. We bow to Christ. We must bow to Christ. Now, I'm going to play another bit of music, and also you'll get an opportunity to ask some questions. I've got a couple of questions already on this, and we'll do that before we finish with another song. But listen to this and tell me if you recognize this, because I wanted to contrast it with Lennon. I'll see if we've got it. Yeah.
I'm not sure if this might interest you, but no. People ask me.
I don't know who that is, but they keep obviously want to get in on the service, and we're not going to let them. If I was super spiritual, I would say it was the devil. But. Right, let's try this. You recognize that? What is it then? Chariots of Fire, who wrote it? Vangelis, genius, absolute genius. And you know how you've seen the opening scene with people running? I've done that on the beach in St. Andrews. You really have to do it. It's one of these bucket list things you have to go and do. You can try it on Newcastle Beach, but it's not nearly the same. Right, I think that's enough. Now, if you've not seen that film, it is on YouTube. You have to see it, not just because it's set in Scotland, not just because it's about a wonderful Scotsman, Eric Liddell, but it's a film made by non-Christians about a Christian who lived his life for the glory of God. And it's an extraordinarily beautiful thing in that you see the grace and truth. You see it. You see how he says to the little boy who's kicking a ball around on a Sunday, and he says to him, I don't know if you remember this scene, he says to this little boy, do you know what day it is? It's Sunday. And whose day is Sunday? It's God's day. And should you be playing football on Sunday? No. Listen, don't. But what are you doing tomorrow morning? Come and meet me and bring your friends and we'll play football. The great Eric Liddell. It was lovely communicating something that was important to him, but with grace. Eric Liddell, of course, as you know, some of you will know anyway, he refused to run on a Sunday in the Olympics and in his chosen event, and they gave him another event. It is an amazing story, and he won a gold medal. And his whole attitude in all that was not triumphant, it was gracious. But one of the things you may not know is Eric Liddell became a missionary to China after that. He promised he would do it to his sister, and he went out to China. He was captured by the Japanese. He was put in a prisoner of war camp and was eventually killed there. But there's an incredible story of how the players, they were unfit, the prisoners were really unfit, and Liddell was asked to arrange a football match, and he did. And it was on a Sunday, and someone said to him, isn't this against your principles? And he said, no, it's not against my principles. This is the only day that the Japanese would allow us to do it. These men need some exercise. And again, he was just incredibly gracious. Grace and truth combined. So, I got a couple of questions. Sometimes people ask me questions afterwards, and I write them down and bring them back. And sometimes people ask in advance. But I want to ask, will anyone here want to ask any? Also, I better look, because sometimes I say, text me them, and you text me them, and I don't look at my phone, which is not very gracious, really, or truthful. Okay, anyone want to ask anything? Okay, I'll start off with this one that I got. This is it's an interesting one because I've heard it many times. When we talk about God's glory, isn't that a bit arrogant? Why would you want to glorify someone? We don't want to glorify ourselves. Shouldn't we be humble? Isn't God humble? Listen, God is God and we are human beings. God is glorified. So if you do something, for example, we've got a wrong idea of humility. You need to read C.S. Lewis on humility. If you painted a beautiful painting and you showed it here and somebody said to you, that's a beautiful painting, and you went, oh no, it's not, it's rubbish really, you're lying, because you know it's actually a beautiful painting, you're very proud of it, but you're being falsely humble. What you should say is, yes, it's a wonderful painting and I thank you for saying that, and I'm so thankful that the Lord has given talent to be able to do that. You know, we've got this kind of false humility, and I think to glorify God, who is the most perfect, most supreme, most beautiful being, that's not arrogant at all. That's why we were made. It's what we were created for. So I don't think it's arrogant at all. There's one I want to do as well. There's a couple others I've got, but how do I get grace? And I'm going to tie that in with a question that's just come in as well. Can we display true graciousness if we've not experienced true grace? No, you can't. It'll always be fake. Because you're doing something. I mean, it will appear gracious. And you can be nice to people, okay? But you can't be really gracious. And now that might cause some of us to despair, because that comes in with the question of how do we get true grace? Well, you can't work it up. You can't say, right, last week I was going to use the word bampo, but that's a Scottish word. So I was a real idiot. I should use my Australian book to work out what you would say. You know, I was just a horrible person last week. But next week, I'm going to be full of grace. I'm just going to go and do it. I'm going to pull up my bootstraps, and I'm just going to be super graceful to everybody. All right, I'll speak to you tomorrow night to see how you're getting on. That's not how it works, okay? So grace, we get grace from Christ. So that's the whole point of saying all this. If you want grace and you want truth, you have to get Christ. And his amazing love is this. He pours out in his grace to people who, in and of themselves, are not graceful. And he changes people. You know, they say, we don't want conversion therapy. Now, I know they're talking about one particular thing. But actually, in this church, we absolutely do want conversion therapy because we need to be converted to be more gracious people, more truthful people, more loving people, more kind people. So we get grace through Christ, and that sounds just such a cliched answer as well. How do we get Christ? Well, that's what we're talking about here, but one of the things is very simple. And this morning we were talking about prayer. Ask him. Just say, Lord, grant me grace. Lord, give me Jesus. Lord, I want you. I want to be able to see what that beauty is. I want to serve you. And even when I don't want to serve you, make me want to serve you. It's one of the most extraordinary things that God gives his grace to those who ask. So ask him. Right, I think we'll finish. Okay, Elizabeth, on you go, quickly. I'm going to come down so I can hear what you're saying.
Loving, pray everything I have.
Yeah.
And I get lonely sometimes. And I get, God give you Jesus, I give you how people get up to heaven and say, how much you've been lost, you're lonely, and I get that. Mm-hmm. I pray you give you Jesus, I give you, I told you, period of after heaven, mm-hmm. and I pray for them too.
Okay. We will do that. Thank you. Thank you. And listen, I'm going to take what you said, and let me just say this. We're lonely, or we struggle because people who are close to us have been taken to heaven or have died. And that's what you need there is the image of the fountain. Because you come to the fountain that never runs dry. Look, can I be honest? I get people fatigue, which is why at the end I'll probably run off. You know, but we do. You get compassion fatigue, those of you who are involved in, you know, caring for other people. You get tired, don't you? You get really, really tired. You can only give so much. You've only got so much to give. But this is the beauty of this. Jesus is a fountain that never runs dry. He never gets compassion fatigue. And he never tires of hearing us coming to him and asking him. And if we're lonely, we come to him and say, Lord, what a friend we have in you. And by the way, that's how you help other people, because you get compassion fatigue. Well, the Lord, if you walk closely with the Lord, he gives you energy. Paul says that in Colossians. He says, how can I do this? He says, I work with all the energy that Christ gives me. That's not to say that Christians don't get tired, but I'm saying restock. That's why it's good if you're a Christian here tonight. I hope you're restocking spiritually so that you've got something to give out in the week. May that be true. I trust in you.